Cinema Royale.
Welcome to Cinema Royale. I am your host at Mike Mixtape.
I'm awake. What the frick just happened?
Got your attention? That's good. All right, let's get this podcast going here. Let me introduce you to my fellow film aficionados. First up, we got at James Sullivan, also known as Jaimetud.
At James Sullivan?
We're promoting your Twitter. Just go with it.
I messed it up, so shut up.
Okay. Tonight's broadcast is brought to you by Cinema Royale's reaction to the link that I've just posted down below, which goes to my Facebook page.
What is it?
Facebook.
Yes.
Nice.
Lord.
Screen grab it, frame it.
I
print it out.
Gonna do it.
Yes. Oh, man.
And returning back from a long hiatus, two episodes at least, Sylvie, also known as Shame on Pretzel.
Yay. Hi. Hey, welcome back. Yay. Great to be back.
Hello.
And from the other spectrum of Canada, Montreal, we got AniMat, also known as Matt Brunet.
Hey, guys!
Great to be back. And I had so much. And I had a great week. How about you?
Great.
Too cold.
Actually, had a good deal of work, so I can't complain.
It's all good in the neighborhood.
Ironically, over here it's sometimes cold. Where you go outside and you determine, it's like, should I have a sweater? No. Okay.
I'll just wear my shorts in the cold.
That's what I still do. I'm still wearing shorts and sandals.
That's what I'm doing too, man.
Trust me, now. Trust me, fall is the time when I would be like Rose and Jack in Titanic when they're like on that like piece of wood. But let go, summer.
Oh man. So you probably read the episode title, you probably clicked on it, it's like, ooh, I'm gonna watch this episode. And of course we're talking about Robin Williams and his films. It's been a month and at least 10 days since he died.
Unfortunately, passed away.
Unfortunately.
Expired.
So, before we talk about films, James has something to say about his death.
Well, or something like that. I don't know about you guys, but Everybody who watches my show remembers how I was crying earlier this year when Baba Hoskins passed away. This was like with Robin Williams though. This was, oh my God. This was like a bout of depression. What you have to know about me is that I pretty much idolized this guy growing up. I mean, he was like one of the guys that, for a while, this was the guy that I wanted to be. And of course, nobody else can be. Or at least be like him. But in any case. That's why I was actually so surprised to, you know, get the news, not just that he was dead, but in how he went. And for a long time afterward, I was thinking probably what most people who were listening to this were thinking, like, why would he do something like that? And I heard a lot of, I heard and I read a lot of theories, and I think I remembered back to when I was a teenager, I read his biography, and I even before that, I went through some bouts of depression myself. When I was a kid, there was a little kid, even. There was a time in my life where I was actually contemplating suicide, and without going into too much detail as to why, when somebody is thinking about suicide, what the thing that gets them to that point, other than just the fact that they, you know, their minds are geared towards depression, is the fact is you have to be made to feel like you're not worth it, no matter what. And when thinking about Sims, I read about his life growing up, there was a lot of times in his childhood where his father was not at home. He was out on some job or whatnot, and he was actually starting at a very young age to make to enter. That was the big thing, was that he always wanted to make his mom laugh when things were down. And I realized something. That was when it all started. You know, that was when the laughter started, and that's when he actually, I think, and turned it into a career. And so when he had his career, when the 90s comes along and he's in one, it was pretty much like one great movie after another for a while with it. It was actually pretty amazing. 1998 comes along, he gets the Oscar for one of his performances, and that was literally him saying to himself, I even watched the speech myself. There's a sort of this little moment where he's thanking his father in heaven for one moment, and it was pretty much to say, this is it, this is the very peak, it's not going to get any better than this. Looking at his career in the past 10 years or so, it hadn't matched up to anything that had happened before. I mean, but let's face it, he did have trouble before with drugs. A lot of comedians do. And he did have trouble with depression. That was mainly why he was using laughter as a method of sort of covering it up. And I think to go back to what I was saying about not feeling like you're worth it, I think with him, a lot of the films that he'd made, that he was frontlining, I think the last time that I genuinely saw him leading, not just being a co-star or a side character or anything, actually leading a good, solid movie was probably 2002 with Death to Smoochie.
Yeah.
And so what my theory is as to why he did it was he had his show recently that got canceled after one season due to low ratings. He's the movie roles that he's been handed for a long time, they haven't been very good. And so he's probably feeling like his greatest weapon, which is laughter, has been taken from him. He's probably feeling like, okay, nobody needs me anymore. And the last bit of it being it looking towards his future, he's probably thinking, okay, I've got Mrs. Doubtfire too. And I've still got all this money to pay off to my ex-wives. And it's not a pleasant living situation. So I just wanted to talk, that's my theory.
Mm-hmm. And that's an interesting theory in general, and I figured
that
makes you think.
Does anyone else have anything to add to that, or?
Sorry, I dropped something. Honestly, not really. No.
Yep. You took it right out of my mind.
It's a really interesting theory, and it does make a lot of sense, you know?
Yeah, it does. So, without further ado, let's,
move on to pleasant things.
move on to
on a brighter note, with more sunshine and rainbows.
Yes, so, he wouldn't want us to still be mourning. He would want us to laugh, so let's find a reason to laugh.
Pretty much.
So, okay, I'm gonna start this off because I probably have his early roles in the '80s for one of those films. Otherwise, you guys have stuff from the '90s and the 2000s. I'm gonna talk about Good Morning America. America, fuck America, fuck America.
Good morning, America.
I screwed up.
We're going to talk about his great interview in Good Morning America.
Yes, that's
and how it outshines his other interview in the Today Show.
Exactly. It was fantastic. You know, he was asking questions and, you know, he was answering them. You know, it was very pleasant. He was very happy about it. No, I'm going to talk about Good Morning Vietnam, which you heard a clip of at the beginning of the episode. That's his catchphrase. So, mm-hmm. Good Morning Vietnam is from 1987. Robin Williams plays Adrian, and he comes to Vietnam from Croatia to become a DJ, a radio DJ. He's supposed to be funny, hilarious. That's why they hired him, because he was so damn funny. And he experienced Vietnam for the first time during the Vietnam War era. So he gets used to Vietnam, he gets on the radio. People love him, but his superiors hate him because it's not the content they want on the radio. You know, it speaks to me because I want to be in radio someday, and I just watched it with my fresh eyes. It's like, whoa, wait a minute. So you're gonna tell me you don't want that joke or that joke or that comedic tone, or you don't want to play this kind of music because it's not what it was back in the day? It's like, blows my mind.
Definitely. So you enjoyed the film because of that?
I enjoyed that. Plus, he was hilarious in his radio broadcast. His radio broadcasts were all ad-libbed. So his comedic style is like he just comes up with shit, boom, 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 constantly. He changes voices. He thinks of something really quick. It's like very quick and constant, and it makes it. It's like, wow, how does he think of that shit that quick? Because I can never do that.
You know, I want to mention that it's kind of funny. You should mention about Good Morning Vietnam. I actually saw it not too long ago after Robin Williams passed away. My parents wanted to do like a marathon of Robin Williams movies, like after his death. So we watched several things like Jumanji and Good Morning Vietnam and a few others. Sorry, my stomach is not working with me, but anyways. What's really interesting about Good Morning Vietnam, and this may be considered overanalyzing or just a theory or whatever, but it's interesting how it really parallels to Robin Williams' career, because here we have a guy who just wants to make people laugh, you know, like, and like with his crazy, like, sharp wit and fast improv, you know, he just wants to make he just wants to put up a good show and make people laugh. But sometimes there are people who really, you know, they just don't like it. You know, like, there are some people who would think that it's too extreme or stuff like that. So, like, sure, there will be some people who will, like, contain him. And that's kind of what happened with his later career. Like, they kind of contain him in crappy comedies mm-hmm. like RV and stuff like that. And it's really interesting, but also there's kind of a part that is a little tragic, because I remember one scene, and it, like, it's both funny and sad at the same time, because it was the scene somewhere in Vienna, I think, is when Robin Williams I think his friend, he drove him to see a bunch of army people go, like, they're ready to go to battle, and like Robin Williams mm-hmm, like. Mm-hmm. Like, he didn't feel like it at first, but then when he got into it, like, he really, like, yeah. He went on and on and on.
Yeah,
There's a funny, and he's even interacting with the people. And that's definitely the comedic part, but the sad part about that is that afterwards, all those people, they're gone. Like, each one of them a lot of them are dead.
I think so. It might be. Because... mind you, it's the Vietnam War, so you got to have that drama in that movie.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, and that setup to that scene was that something happens. I'm not going to spoil it, because it's actually one of a very heart-wrenching moment when that moment happens in the film. Mm-hmm. He decides...
I don't even remember.
Something happens at a local place where he witnessed something, and he decided, you know what? I'm done. I'm done with the radio. I'm not going to... No, I'm done. I'm going to stay in Vietnam, do nothing. And Forrest Whitaker plays his buddy in the film.
It's Forrest Whitaker. Oh,
yeah. And funny thing, my first impressions of him kind of looked like he was the black nerd.
Like Andre the Black Nerd?
Yeah, Andre the Black Nerd. I just, the way he sounded like and the way he talked, it just made me reminded of. There was another character in the film. What was it? There was this... jackass of a character. He sounds like Joe Pesci.
Maybe.
It was like it reminded me of Goodfellas at one point.
Okay. It actually is Joe Pesci, maybe. I don't know.
It wasn't. It's a different actor, but it just sounded just like him. Just, it's weird. It has its highs and lows. It's got comedy. It's got drama. I laughed. I enjoyed it. And, you know, seeing... Adrian, or AC as they nicknamed him, experienced Vietnam for the first time. You know, he's enjoying the food, and he's like, hot! In a comedic moment. There's mm-hmm. there's also, like, a twist in the movie, too. If you watch it, you'll find out about someone in the film. I'm not gonna... Yeah, I suggest you actually watch the film, because I think it's a really good... And it's actually a good early career move mm-hmm. of... Robin Williams.
I'm gonna say something after what you guys said here. That's actually probably gonna be pretty dangerous. I know that a lot of people love this movie. I'm actually not one of those people. And there's a certain reason as to why. After having watched it myself, I realized something. Because I had been warned about a few things before watching it. I had seen bits and pieces of interviews from the real Adrian Cronauer, who, by the way, hates the movie.
Based on a true story?
Yeah, it's loosely based on a true story. Because they
didn't show you how it really was. They showed it to you how they thought you would want to see it.
Yeah.
And that's actually my main problem with this movie is that Robin Williams was everything, and the short version of it is Robin Williams was everything that Adrian Cronauer was not, especially as a radio DJ. He was, in reality, Cronauer was not hired to do comedy. He was just hired to come in and report stuff. The comedy aspect was written in there so that Robin Williams could do what he was good at, which is comedy, and not just any brand of comedy, improv comedy, which works in stand-up, but when you're trying to depict somebody else's life and you're making up things that they said that they never said, it's sort of problematic for me. And the other thing is his superiors actually did not hate him in the army. He was not kicked out at any point. He just finished his term and went home. Sorry, that's a bit of a giveaway there, but
yeah, it's a given.
I
knew this ahead of time prior to watching the film, and yeah. I mean, yeah, if you're going to tell a story about somebody, you delve into it. You don't make up shit and just put it out there. I mean, I understand what you're going for, James. But with my mind, I'm thinking, like, you know what? Despite that information, it really felt like a good film with the comedy, the drama. I was heart-wrenched during the film when the drama parts. Like, the Vietnam stuff, I was like, oh shit, holy crap, that happened.
Do you think
funny, I didn't feel a thing.
Would it have been as well if they went the more straight route, like if they got an actor that more better depicted the character?
Well that's the thing, thank you for finally chiming in. That's the thing. The whole problem that I have with the film is from the ground up. Their attitude towards making it is not to depict accuracy. And they probably took a look at his story and said, you know what, this isn't interesting enough. He has to be a little bit more of a rebel. He has to be a bit more of this. This is going to make Oscar gold right here. And if a story is not interesting enough as it is, I think the best thing to do is just sort of leave it.
Yeah, I can
see that. If that answers your question.
Who knew? Good Morning Vietnam was Patch Adams before Patch Adams.
Yes. Well, They could have gotten away with it, maybe, in my opinion, if they said inspired by a true story and made up made it up from the ground up about some guy who's not named Adrian Cronauer.
Yeah, it's pretty much like if you take Surf's Up and you say that's a true story.
It's not.
But I keep hearing this whole thing about penguin surfing competitions year after year. How could this not be a true story?
Well, you know, with the success of the penguin movies like March of the Penguins, they do have to change a few things.
Artistic liberties and all that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. No, but it's actually true that Surf's based on a true story, but it's like, you know, they do have to change a few things to change the subject a bit. Like, let's go back to a little bit on Robin Williams, shall we?
How much farther do we need to get off topic? No.
I guess not that far. I'm surprised.
I just wanted to make a comparison, you know?
From Vietnam to penguins. I love that segue.
Good morning, Vietnam! Hey, this is not a test. This is rocket.
I'm sure Robin Williams said penguin in the movie somewhere.
That'll be brought up later. let's move it. Move Good Morning Vietnam to the side and let James talk about this film.
Okay, I wanted to start off with I did watch a marathon of Robin Williams films as well. I wanted to start off with my decisive two picks of Williams films. I decided to go with one that I knew and loved and one that I hadn't seen yet. So I'm going to start off with the one that I hadn't seen yet, which is The Birdcage.
Ooh, that was a good one. The what?
Mm-hmm.
Hey? Before you go on, I have heard of it. I've seen clips of it, but not fully seen it.
Okay.
Proceed.
Here is the spiel about this film. Directed by, I believe...
Mike
Nichols. Yes. This is a film in which Robin Williams and Nathan Lane play a gay couple. Williams is in charge of a drag queen nightclub. Of which Nathan Lane is the star. And Williams in the film has a son from a previous relationship, who is grown up now and getting married. And in order to make themselves look appropriate to the family which they're marrying into, they decide to make a few small presentable changes to themselves, namely dressing down their house so that it doesn't have so many naked statues around the place.
I'm sure they gotta clean up the whole place.
Making Nathan Lane's character act less, flamboyant, and introducing him as the boy's uncle. And this is all stuff that they're planning to do, but you know where this is going. I mean, this is a comedy, so that this is all gonna fall flat on their face in the third act.
Hijinks.
Mm-hmm. Hijinks ensue.
Hijinks with a gay Robin Williams and a regular Nathan Lane.
Which is just...
Yeah, that was one aspect of the film that I did enjoy. Nathan Lane fits into a category I actually did not know until a couple of years ago that Nathan Lane was gay. when I found out about it, I was like, okay, well, this explains Timon and Pumbaa's relationship. Okay.
You see, this is why I have a problem with Pumbaa's gas.
Oh my god.
But seriously though, in every role that I've seen him in, he plays it off like he's one of the straightest gay guys ever in cinema history. And here, oh my goodness, he is such a drag queen. It's amazing. If you look at this character, you'd be like, oh wow, this is Nathan Lane? Really, really stretching himself as an actor. That's one of the things that I like about it. What I don't like about it, and this sort of dominates the film, is that it paints the world into two extremes, and it takes itself too seriously to be enjoyed. I can't believe I just said that. It takes itself too seriously. Let me try to elaborate a little bit more on that point. The family that they're marrying into, they're not just straight people. They're straight-laced, conservative, politically Republican Richard Nixon posing in pictures, and oh my goodness, it's like a cookie cutter all on its own. And so that's their depiction of the extreme right, and on the extreme left you have Robin Williams and Nathan Lane, two of the gayest couple that you're ever going to meet, who ironically don't kiss during the whole course of the film. But they have soup bowls that have paintings of men doing it with each other when you get to the bottom of the bowl. That's how gay these guys are. And it's actually...
Well, whatever encourages you to eat your soup.
And it's actually... It actually comes up as sort of a gag when they... when they're having dinner with this other couple, is that when they get to the bottom of it, they're like, oh, well, it seems to be a very interesting painting here. What are these two young men doing? You know, they don't show you what they're doing, but, you know, the film describes in dialogue. Because, oh, and fun fact, this is actually based off of a play. They want to leave it up to your imagination. But
I can imagine that scenario. I can actually imagine that scenario. It's like, oh, what are they doing? Oh, they're doing doggy. They're looking for their doggy. They're looking under the covers for their doggy.
They had a perfectly good opportunity here to not take themselves too seriously, and yet they somehow managed to. And when you come across something, when you have caricatures that are this extreme, the best way to deal with it is like, dare I say it, a better way to deal with it would be something like South Park, where there is oftentimes a point being made, but no sides really being taken. Because how can you take it seriously when it looks like a fifth grader could crank out better animation? That's my two cents on it, at least. I mean, if I was marrying off any of my kids, I came across a soup bowl that had something like that at the bottom, I would have a lot of questions and say to myself, you know, do I really want to be related to these people? It would be a meet the parents situation.
Oh God! Like, he'll just be there, like all Robert De Niro, like,
"I got my eyes on you too.
You hold on. Don't a sec. I gotta teach my nephew to do that."
I don't want you guys to go out humping in public while we're at restaurants or something. Yeah.
Oh my God.
So that's all I have to say on it, I guess.
Yeah. I haven't seen the movie interested, because I am also a fan of Nathan Lane, and like hearing that a gay couple of Robin Williams and Nathan Lane in a movie actually exists, I was like, this I gotta see. But hearing that it does take itself seriously, I was like, maybe when it randomly appears, maybe, I don't know.
I think it has to take itself seriously, though, because you gotta keep in mind the time, like, this is the mid-90s, right? Mm-hmm. People weren't really accepting of homosexual relationships or even homosexual lifestyle. Look at Ellen DeGeneres around that time when she came out, when Rosie came out, you know, the ratings went down. People just weren't ready to accept that. So I guess playing it straight rather than doing something too, I don't know, lighthearted, like, I guess they weren't ready to really make light of such a controversial topic at that time. So maybe that's why it was like that.
Yeah, but really, when they exaggerate, like, it was the other way around. Yeah, but like, James does have a point. If you really are going to exaggerate the characters, like, you can't really take it so seriously, you know?
That's true.
And
I know it's a really touchy subject, but if you're going to have fun with it, try to have fun with it.
Mm-hmm. I mean, well, there are some moments where they are going for laughs, but okay, so if you want to see Nathan Lane in drag, let me put it that way.
I'll say this for any producers fans: if you want to see Max Bialystock be Roger Debris, then this is it.
Mm-hmm.
Makes sense.
So yeah, shall we move on?
We shall move on. I'm gonna pass it on over to Sylvie.
Oh God. Okay, so I was originally going to talk about Ferngully. I'd even watched it yesterday, but given the circumstance, I had to scramble and think of another movie, which wasn't too hard. I've seen my fair share of Robin Williams movies, So I wanted to choose one that, while he's playing a comedic role, or I should say he's playing a role that you wouldn't immediately associate with Robin Williams. Like a lot of the movies, for example, like the Good Morning Vietnam, he's comedic. Ferngully's comedic. Aladdin, he's comedic. I wanted to pick a movie where he was playing something kind of out of type. Kind of like what Jim Carrey tries to do, but he's still not quite getting it.
He doesn't have the hang of it.
Right. For some reason, Robin Williams he can do it, but it's almost eerie when he does. So I had a choice. I was going to watch 1 Hour Photo, but I don't think I was in the right frame of mind to watch that one. So I watched what James had talked about earlier, Death to Smoochie. I rewatched that one earlier today because I did see it actually a few years ago, and I liked it. It's different. It's directed by Danny DeVito, and the only other movie I know that I've seen that Danny DeVito's done is Matilda, which is one of my favorite childhood films. I love Matilda. I just love the direction and everything about it. So I thought the reason why I picked Death to Smoochie is because it's Robin Williams. He's playing tight, but then he's not, because he's being comedic and you know, goofy, but he's the villain. He's essentially the bad guy in this film. He plays a child entertainer called Rainbow Randolph. Mm-hmm. And so he wears a bright, flashy coat, and he's dancing with the kids. He's kind of like Bozo the Clown without really being a clown. He's just like in flamboyant clothes, but he's corrupt and he smokes and he takes bribes and he's just all around mean-spirited, and he swears. So he gets caught in a sting, I guess, by the FBI or by the authorities, and so he's blackballed by the network, and they take away his show, they take away his time slot. He ends up on the street. How he ends up on the street, I don't know. He must be really bad with money, because he goes from being like this big shot in the children's entertainment world to like basically being a bum, and which is another weird thing about this movie, because it takes place in New York City. Like most of the story takes place in New York, and yet it seems like the whole world, all they care about is like childhood shows. Like there's big billboards of. Mm-hmm. It's a weird universe where it's the child shows that are like the prime time, the money makers, which kind of makes sense because of all the merchandise and the stupid kids buying the paint and the blowtorches and the prophylactics and all that stuff. But I'm just using examples.
So. Kids buying prophylactics? I don't remember this.
Anyway, so the network's scrambling to find someone that they can use that's inoffensive and, you know, could just go along and have no hiccups. So they go to the bottom of the list and they find this like down and out like hippie guy who he's a good guy. He goes to drug like methadone clinics and hospitals, and he sings for free. He sings like pro bono for them. So they get this woman who I can't remember her name, but she's like lady bitch face in it, and she goes and she gets him, and she says, okay, we need you to take over for Rainbow Randolph. You can do your smoochie routine, because he's basically dresses as a rhinoceros. It's basically a ripoff of Barney, obviously, because Barney's a purple dinosaur and he's a pink rhinoceros. So that's basically the shtick of the story, is that Edward Norton is playing playing Smoochie. Edward Norton plays Smoochie or Sheldon, and he's the one that's navigating this whole like dark, seedy underbelly of the childhood entertainment industry, where there's kickbacks and just all sorts of corrupt things going on. So he wants to run things his way, and I don't know, maybe I couldn't follow the story that well, but it gets kind of muddled where he's working for the network, but there's someone else who runs like the whole like children donation like pride parade organization, and they kind of own everything, and they take like they skim off the top of all the big events that deal with children shows and like ice shows and stuff. So it goes from him trying to navigate being in this like world that's supposed to be so innocent but at the same time so dark, and at the same time him avoiding Robin Williams' advances of revenge, because he basically the whole movie is feeling like, I hate Smoochie. He's going around, he's seeing people who are doing Save the Rhino campaigns, and he's freaking tackling them in the middle of downtown. And there's actually a scene I want to bring up, because I didn't realize this until after. There was a lot of talk about a lot of the roles that Robin Williams did where there's suicide involved. There is a scene 3/4 into the film where all of Robin Williams' attempts, or all of Randolph's attempts to get rid of Smoochie have failed. He's in front of a crowd. He's pointing at a screen with Smoochie's like, this is the pariah. This is the enemy. And he takes this gas can, and he just pours it all over himself. And he's going to, like, incinerate himself in front of the whole crowd. So he lights the match. And then this little girl comes out and is like, stop, don't. And she comes out, and she blows out the match. And he doesn't kill himself. And I don't know. It's kind of sad, because it obviously makes you think of Robin Williams in his last days. You wish there was someone, like, there for him. He called this little girl his angel later in the film, but it's too bad that in his twilight, in his later years, he didn't have that little girl, like figuratively and like literally, metaphorically, just there to whisper in his ear and say, "Don't do it." So, that's kind of a sad scene. But in the end, Randolph does find redemption. The bad guys get their comeuppance. Randolph and Smoochie team up, and then everything's relatively hunky-dory at the end. They're with a few deaths sprinkled in, but you know they don't really matter. But so it's definitely a film. If you're talking dark comedy, that's probably one of the better dark comedies, I guess, Robin Williams has been in. I definitely loved it. I was glad to see it for a second time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. What makes Death to Smoochie work? And I was actually, when this film first came out, my impressions of it were almost like it was briefly inspired by history in children's television, because I remember the days of when Pee Wee's Playhouse was actually running, and then a scandal brought that show down, and it was already sort of on its way out the door to begin with, but the scandal was what really did it, and then seemingly out of nowhere comes this big purple dinosaur that that becomes a hit with kids, but or at least with little tiny kids. I was at the age where I was sort of over that, and actually I was the crowd that was making fun of Barney. So that was the parallel that I drew when the film first came out. But what makes it work actually is Williams's character. For a comedy, yes, he is this is him at his mean-spiritedness.
Mm-hmm.
his most mean-spirited as far as doing humor, but his character has an arc that has a turnaround at the end, and I think even with dark comedies, it for me, kind of ruins it if they decide that they're gonna still end the thing on a sour note. Like if Randolph had just said "damn it all" and charged at Smoochie with an explosive jacket or something like that. It would have been a terrible way to end the film, but it makes it work when he turns around as a character, and it as far as the chemistry goes, Norton's character Smoochie, or the guy that plays Smoochie, he has an arc to go with as well. He faces, he's a sweet, innocent guy who faces off against all this corruption that's in the entertainment industry, and it almost affects him to the point where he bends to the corruption. And what's amazing is that he does not. He's able to rebound from it, and he's able to get a friend. It's kind of like the Will Ferrell formula before Will Ferrell.
Yeah, that's.
When you think about it, good.
Huh? Makes sense.
In a way. I couldn't imagine Will Ferrell doing a dark comedy though, unless he's already done it. I'm not aware. Most of his movies are. Yeah, it's just comedy.
Here's the Will Ferrell formula. Will Ferrell plays an established celebrity type in his profession. Up comes a do-gooder opponent. They rat fist each other for the entire premise of the film, and then by the end of it all, they build a bridge and become friends. That's the plot to Blades of Glory. That's the plot to The Campaign. That's the plot to
Anchorman.
Even Anchorman.
Talladega Nights.
Okay.
I see what you're saying. Then you got a point.
That does make sense. Yeah.
Death to Smoochie is the Will Ferrell formula. Will Ferrell, you owe Robin Williams your career.
And let's not forget neo-Nazis.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yes. This Heil Smoochie. Yes.
Oh, my God.
Best part of the movie, I swear to God. I love that.
Heil Smoochie.
Heil Smoochie.
What would possess a bunch of, like, 30, 40-year-old, like, white supremacists to want Smoochie to sing at their Hitler rally? I'm not sure what made them think that he was someone who might be pro-Third Reich or something like that. I don't know. I don't see the connection.
I just thought it was just like, doesn't even know it, all of a sudden. Oh, my God.
Ta-da!
It's like, That color purple is just so fascist, you know?
Oh, of course.
And overpowering.
You know what that rhino reminds me of? Hitler. He should be in our rally. Hitler was a great rhino.
What?
You got my quote of the day already, Matt.
Well, it's going to be a new day soon in my end, so you can use that as your quote of the day.
That actually ends that discussion so perfectly. I'm going to make Matt go ahead, Matt. Talk about your film next.
All right. Well, it's actually really a coincidence that I mentioned Robin Williams and Penguins, because the one movie that I'm going to talk about is another of his animated films. I've already talked about Aladdin. I've already talked about Ferngully. Now, I'll be talking about Happy Feet. Yes, the 2006 Academy Award-winning Happy Feet, which I'm really surprised. Now, the one thing that I always say about Happy Feet is that I find it to be the Moulin Rouge of animated features. Because, funny enough, not only because it's a jukebox musical, but also it actually shares a lot of its strengths and its flaws. Now, for its strengths, this is definitely one of the best computer animations I have ever seen. Oh my god. Now, of course, the penguins really do look like penguins. But not only that, when they come to life, and like this amazing choreography, it is spectacular. It's just so amazing to watch. And, like, the animators have done such a phenomenal job at it. And, like, it really is interesting to see such, like I said, such amazing choreography and such realistic animation. But, like, you really do believe that they are dancing penguins. And it really is interesting. And funny enough, there was at one point when you actually do see live people, and that was one thing that I was really interested to see, is how would they do people. I was so amazed. I was like, oh my god, they look so good, they actually look real. And then I just realized, wait a minute, they are real. They actually use cameras. Oh, that's disappointing.
Real people alongside, like, cartoon characters? Who would have thought?
Yeah, that's what I thought as well. I was like, oh my god! I was like, oh no, those are actual people. No, but as for the flaws, there are some flaws with it as well.
Mm-hmm.
The problems I have with Happy Feet is that, holy crap, the writing is really messed up. There's a lot of things that are inconsistent and a lot of things that really doesn't make sense. The biggest thing that I have, and it really is, it's really aggravating when I watch the movie, is that the penguins have no concept in dancing. They don't know what that is. They only know singing. And, like, whenever you would see Mumble go dance around, like, they're just confused and it makes no sense. And that's why they consider him an outcast. That, and he cannot sing. That is explainable. But it's like, I was like, what are you doing with your feet? It's like, you don't know what dancing is? It's like, you've been doing this whole time. You freaking morons. It's like, you know, I feel like I want to rewind. It's like, what is this? What are you doing? You are freaking dancing. That's you're doing. That what you think your son is doing is weird.
It's choreographed waddling. Yes. Singing and waddling.
Yes. Singing and waddling.
This.
But it's so dumb. It's like, nothing makes sense. And even the plot itself, it's so inconsistent. Like, there are times, like, you don't know what Mumble's relationship with that one girl is. It's like, it doesn't make sense. It's like, what the hell are you doing? It's like, that's the thing. Not a lot of things make sense here.
Mm-hmm.
But on to Robin Williams. He actually played two characters. There's Lovelace, which is pretty much considered, like, the almighty penguin. And then there's, well, except for the Emperor Penguins are their own class, but for, like, other penguins, like, he's the major one. And also Ramon. Ramon, I must say, I have never seen a character that is this funny, this hilarious, and this enjoyable to watch since his performance as the genie. He plays this more romantic kind of character where he's like Pepe Le Pew, always chasing girls and stuff. But every moment is just downright funny. And he's also the leader of this gang. It's like, he always knows the exact same thing. Like, I remember the funniest thing that I've seen is that when Mumble meets the girl that he likes, like, he was there and was like, don't worry, mademoiselle. Do not fright. I love you. And it's like,
I know, size may be daunting, but don't be afraid.
Yes, exactly. It's like so out of nowhere, and it's like so fast paced. It's just downright hilarious, and it's and like Robin Williams really makes it enjoyable to watch. Like, sure, the writing is messed up, but I gotta say, Robin Williams' performance in there as Ramon alone is as fantastic as the animation itself. Now, for Happy Feet, I don't know if I would consider it best animated feature Oscar-worthy, but it's still a really good film nonetheless.
What did it beat out? I can't remember.
It beat out Monster House and Cars. So, to its credit...
Oh, it was a weak year, though.
Yeah, it didn't have much competition.
I don't know. I think Cars is sort of a little bit more holding its test of time, at least the first one.
Cars is okay, but nothing too big to honk the to honk the Oscars, you know.
The big question with Happy Feet, and I was excited. I was all over that when it was coming out. I had to see it in theaters, et cetera, et cetera. And I keep thinking back on it, and already I'm thinking, was that just a lot of hype that I was going for, or has it really aged well as a film? And to be honest, I find the set pieces engaging, but I don't really invest myself so much in the music. I wouldn't say that I went out and bought the soundtrack for any or anything. It just it's an interesting blend of visuals and medleys that works just for entertainment purposes, but that's sort of just the film right there.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think the hype would, if I can recall, the hype would mostly come from, I remember Prince was involved writing, was working on the songs, pretty much. So I think that's where, people really paid attention. I just want to check. I think that would be it. I'm pretty sure Prince was involved because he did get awards.
Yeah, he wrote us. He was so enamored, in fact, by how they used one of his songs in the film that it inspired him to write a song that ended up in the credits of the movie.
And I think that ended up winning awards, I think.
I think they had a famous tap dancer in it, too. Someone named Savion Glover? Correct me if I'm wrong on that, like the choreography.
Yeah, it's complicated. For the one thing I'll really give the film is that they worked hard at blending so many different sources for their presentation.
I agree.
The folks at Animal Logic were studying penguin movement. They had to motion track penguins, and then they had to do their thing where they make the animation.
Wait, did they actually do motion capture on the penguins?
I think.
How else
are
they gonna get them to do the tap dancing? How else would they?
Well, the tap dancing, that was actually a motion reference by Savion Glover.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm.
So
actually, if
I don't know how they merged
even
that.
Even like the high speed tap dancing, if I recall, that's not actual tap dancing. That's with hands.
That's with hands?
Really?
Yeah. For like the major ones, it was like...
Oh,
they had to, like,
right.
There's a guy, he had to put in like tap dancing
artist.
Shoes, and so I was like...
Interesting. Interesting.
The magic of Foley.
I think you have to give the movie more credit in the department of like integrating live action with CGI too. I can't remember if a lot of the snow was live action. I can't remember if some of the scenery was actual snow. But you have to give the movie credit for combining the live action towards the end, like with the actual people and the CGI. Because there's two other movies I can think of that it's not seamless, or they implement it, but it doesn't work well, or there's not a harmony to it. Dinosaur. Mm. Dinosaur is actually a marriage of CGI and yes. computer animation.
Oh, yeah.
And the trailer, like, the trailer for Dinosaur was gorgeous. And it made me, I don't know if you guys ever saw a Fantasia, but, like, you know that the dinosaur segment? Like, that's immediately what I was thinking. I was so pumped for that. And then you actually get the movie, and it's all, like, 90% rock and, like, CGI and dinosaurs.
And then you get that love monkey.
don't say that. Yeah, so that's
yeah.
one that it didn't live up to the hype. And the other movie, it was a short segment, but it just felt jarring. It's Wall-E. It was Pixar's first attempt at the mixing CGI and live action. I don't know the name of the actor.
The only live action scenes are during the videos.
Yeah, I know, but it felt odd, because there'd never been in any other Pixar movie, like, actual human beings in a Pixar film. So when I saw it, I just felt that was really jarring. It didn't quite mesh, maybe because you just know the universe of Pixar.
Well,
but
I suppose. Well, it's also to contrast how they are right now. Well, how they are, like, in the movie, because now they're, like, fat to the point where they're, like, five times their average, they're five times the size that they're supposed to be.
Yeah, but I'm hesitant to say realistic, because yeah, of course they're like morbidly obese, but it doesn't look like, even with all that time passing, that they could go from that to that. It didn't look seamless. So
it
that's
takes centuries.
Okay, that's fair.
Just consider the credits roll like centuries gone by.
It's a perversion of the theory of evolution. We're Pixar. We can do whatever we want.
And people will love us because we're Pixar.
Not me. I'm off that bandwagon. Wait, I have a... Yeah, I am.
We've already had this argument. You missed it.
Yeah, we're not.
No.
Let's not tread there again. I had one more question, though. Matt, what did you think of Happy Feet 2?
It sucks. It is so bad. Oh god, the writing is so the writing is even worse. It's so stupid. Oh my god, I don't really recall much, but I remember that it's bad. Like, and even Robin Williams, like, he was really dumbed down. He's not even funny in there. Like, not even his humor can save the film. And if I can recall, like there are so many moments that are so random. And it's basically recycling the same film as last time, because now, instead of being a dancer, Mumble's son is now, like, an opera singer, which suddenly at the end...
It sounded like somebody was strangling a chipmunk when that happened.
Just right on the neck.
I've heard one great review.
And the kings are fools.
just the magic.
Yeah, I remember I heard one. I heard one review where they pretty much best described it as, like, it's suddenly out of nowhere going,
"You called him a coward. Leave him alone."
And also, and then there's also Matt Damon and Brad Pitt. I think it's these two.
The gay prime.
Yeah, the gay
like, Will what and, the?
Will.
The
Bill
gay
and
krill.
The krill.
Will and Billy.
So, yeah. Like, making so many krill jokes.
Why?
And it's pointless. It's so pointless to the movie. There is no purpose. It's like they want to make... Like, they want to make, like, Scrat from Ice Age, but they don't know how to do it. So, like, Like, you cut to them, and they have exactly no purpose to the film at all.
It would have worked if they had so much as had a dialogue with the penguin characters, or if they were somehow interlaced. But it seems like every time the krill come on screen, they just distract with this other story that's going on.
Yeah.
And it's like, okay, there's one point where one of the krill lands on a penguin's nose, and you're like, okay, finally these two stories are going to intersect, and it's going to make sense of it all. And then all of a sudden, the krill flies off. And it's like, oh, no.
Yeah, let's just say that the chances of them having a point to the original story is one in a krillion. To be stealing a line in the movie. Trust me, they said that several times. So.
Jeez, you're kind of broken. Get a wood in there for a second. All right, I'm gonna have to ask a question about this because I have not seen both of the films. So you guys were great inspiration. But I know one thing about the film, and I know it's the director. What's the direction like? Because this is the first...
Which one? Oh, George Miller?
George Miller.
George Miller is known for...
Mad Max
trilogy.
Yes.
And this is his first adventure into animation, pretty much. Not bad.
Mm-hmm.
It just blew my mind, because it's like, wait, the guy who made Mad Max, Mad Max 2 The Road Warrior... did a segment in the Twilight Zone, the movie, Beyond Thunderdome, and Babe, Pig in the City, and now he's doing an animated film? What is going on?
Well, you just answered it. He did Babe. So,
that kid. He grew up and got married, and probably, well, I don't know. Is he married?
Babe
with kids?
2. Babe 2.
No, he actually did
2.
Did he both produce 2. Babe 2?
2.
That's not, 2. That's not, the second one.
Not the original. He produced the first, and he also directed the second.
Yeah.
I never saw the second one. I just know it was the death of...
Don't even watch it. It's not worth it. I had it on VHS
what's your question,
as a
Mike?
Kid. I just want to know the direction of the films. It's just like...
The direction?
What do you mean?
I don't know. It's just...
It's just out there. Things happen.
Like what kind of signature directions that George Miller would have?
Big open spaces, right?
Yes, big open spaces.
Yep,
that's all I got.
there is that in Happy Feet. Like often, like you would see, like the big Antarctica. So, oh yeah, definitely. So there's a lot of big spaces. Oh, but I just remembered. You want to know what's the randomest moment in Happy Feet 2? Okay, so you know that there is... it's a jukebox musical, so there is well-known songs. Mm-hmm. In Happy Feet, they have good ones.
Mm-hmm.
In Happy Feet 2, they have the randomest choice of them all, and I cannot believe that they actually did that, is when one of the birds... It's like a different bird came in, and he's supposed to be, like, people believe he's a flying bird, but he's actually not. But and it's obvious from the start. But he comes down, and he actually goes, "Hi, I ever sing the song of my people? Maya he, Maya who, Maya
no shit.
Maya ha,
no way.
Maya he, Maya who, Maya ha, Maya ha, tres tres tal no man no maye, no man no man no maye, no man no man no maye."
It's kind of like putting Gangnam Style on the Nut Job, you know? It's that level of datedness.
Exactly.
Oh my god.
It wasn't even dated when Happy Feet 2 did it. It's like,
yeah.
Okay.
It's kind of like, okay, we're being trendy here. So let's be trendy. And that's the whole thing with the Happy Feet movies, I think, period. They were trendy. I'm gonna say that they were trendy.
But they tried to do a lot of
a lot of popular songs like Under Pressure or Somebody to Love and all that stuff. A lot of them are great. I will admit, I really do enjoy a lot of the segments, more than just the animation, but also some of the songs are well done as well. Like, I would often listen to, like, Boogie Wonderland. That was fun. That's a fun one. That really is.
Boogie Wonderland is a good song.
Mm-hmm. And even the way that the movie does it. I do get it where it's, like, it is trendy, and, like, they would often go to, like, 80s to 90s music.
From the get-go, I mean, it's a movie about penguins in a time when they were making movies about penguins.
Yeah, it's...
Penguins were a trend.
Mm-hmm. Although, funny enough, there's only three films that I can recall that it's a major penguin movie. Happy Feet, March of the Penguins, and Surf's Up.
I got another one. This is what I wanted
Pebble
to say.
Penguin?
Yes. I was going to say the direction was Pebble and the Penguin meets Moulin Rouge. That's a direction,
yes.
Essentially. That's it.
That's actually true. That's actually
and he
true.
Left. He missed it, but.
This is the version where she gets consumption and dies at the end.
Although it is ironic, they don't have like that. Happy Feet doesn't have like. Doesn't have a villain where his boobs are bigger than the rest of his body.
Drake, man.
And freaking Drake. Oh, I get it. You're joking. But Tim Curry, man.
Brilliant.
I will admit, Pebble and the Penguin is not that bad. It's like, it's okay. It's okay at the most. I mean,
I've said things about it.
Well, I'm not saying it's good, but you know.
We need to start talking more about Robin Williams movies now that
Mike
is back.
Oh yeah, sorry, we're going off talking.
That's true. We went a lot on penguins.
Yes, indeed.
I'll just put it back here.
And that was graceful that I went to the bathroom as you stopped talking about it.
Okay, Mike, what's up next?
I've been having a case of insomnia lately. Hint, hint, wink, wink.
No, I don't know.
In 2002, same year as Death of Smoochie, Robin Yay. Williams was also in a film called Insomnia. Let me go on. Like I said, I stayed up to watch Insomnia while having insomnia. I swear to God, I kept on, like, I wasn't bored by the film, but I was so tired from, because out of all the days I wanted to look up stuff on Netflix, all of a sudden I got a bit, you gotta update your payment method, and I didn't have my credit card on me, so I had to find other ways to watch movies. So I researched and researched. I was like, okay, I originally wanted to do Jumanji, but I was like, you know what, I want to be adventurous and watched two Robin Williams films I have never seen before in my life. Good Morning Vietnam, and as I discover about Insomnia, it's pretty interesting.
Mm.
First off, it's directed by Christopher Nolan.
Mm-hmm.
It was his third directed film. Two, it's a remake of a Norwegian film. Three, Robin Williams is a supporting character in this. And four, Al Pacino is in this film.
Really?
So, Insomnia.
Robin Williams, yeah, let's see. Insomnia, this is the plot of the... This is the movie where Al Pacino can't sleep because he's having bad dreams of being in an Adam Sandler movie, right?
Oh, and that he's dating Adam Sandler.
Oh my God, that was good. Yeah, Al Pacino plays a LA detective who has to go to Alaska to solve this murder, homicide, crime of a 17-year-old, and it's a typical, you don't see Robin Williams until, you know, in the middle of a movie, so you have to sit through Al Pacino being Al Pacino, you know, and trying to solve this crime, you know, and he's in Alaska, of course, he doesn't know anything about Alaska, so he's like, they wanted to ask a student questions, and he's like, all right, let's go to the school, let's take him out of class, and we'll question him. And the locals are like, it's 10. Okay, let's go. It's 10 p.m., and it's light out. Because Alaska's 24/7 light until it gets dark in the wintertime. So hilarity ensues with that. So as time goes on, we don't know who the killer is. We try to figure it out, you know, piece by piece by piece. Then all of a sudden, we have a connection between the victim and the killer. Here comes in Robin Williams. He plays as Alaskan writer, a crime novelist, a struggling... Well, I guess he's pretty famous because the victim was a big fan of his. And, uh-oh, the truth is, spoiler alert, he does kill the victim here, the 17-year-old. So he is the bad guy in this film.
Oh, my.
But this is a very subtle, subtle villain here, because compared to Death to Smoochie, Death to Smoochie was way better. He was over the top with it. In Insomnia, he is like, oh, he's villainous. You know, he's got the tone voice. He plays like a little cat and mouse game with Al Pacino, because another point of the film is like he brought his partner with from L.A. and they're chasing after the killer. They thought they were, and it's foggy outside, and all of a sudden Al Pacino sees a figure. Bam! Actually, kills his partner.
Nice.
Wow.
So, like you do.
So, later on, we realize that Robin Williams witnessed the whole thing. He's seen the killing of the partner. So that's a little blackmail for Al Pacino. He's like, all right, we'll make a deal here. We'll blackmail it. You know, if you do this, I won't tell anybody about this. And it goes on and on for throughout the film. It's like a little cat and mouse game, like I said. It's pretty interesting. You know, he's on the phone sometimes like, hey, having trouble sleeping lately? I know you're not used to this, but you got insomnia going on here. It was pretty cool. But then you get to see him face to face for the first time, because there's a chase scene where Al Pacino goes into his place to look for evidence, and all of a sudden he sees Rob Williams running away. And I've never seen Rob Williams run in this chase before, because he's like running and he's jumping over logs like a Frogger. Boing, 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 boing. I'm just like, is that really him, or is it a stunt double? It's just weird.
Because that is the question we never asked about him. Is Robin Williams fit? He is most certainly hairy, but does he have any muscles behind the fur?
Oh. I was actually quite sure that maybe he did. Maybe he did a lot of his own stunts.
I thought it looked like Tim, actually, when he was doing it. So they agree to meet up later on, and he's not comedic at all. He's just, like, he's very...
Straight up.
No. Lower than that. He's, like, very quiet. Very quiet. You can see him, like, hold back his true Robin Williams-ness. He's just like, you know, I'm gonna kill you someday. I'm gonna kill you.
He's just like, up on that Ritalin.
So Insomnia, Robin Williams' character has, you know, when it comes to villainy, kind of think of it like a cat and mouse game, you know, like the Riddler that he was supposed to be in Batman. Yeah, did you know that? Did you know that?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
because
well, I do now.
Yeah, but he lost to Jim Carrey because Jim Carrey was being busy becoming it for that point.
Yeah, there was a quote too that like he wanted to be in the Nolan trilogy too. Like he was like, I want to be realer, and I don't know if he could stick me into the movies. Like, you know, I had two chances because he actually was offered the part of the Joker in Batman, but he lost to Jack Nicholson. And then, was it Batman Forever? He was offered the Riddler, and he got turned down. So it was Jim Carrey. So he wanted to be a Batman villain. So that was pretty cool, actually, to think about that.
That would make a lot of sense. That would be awesome to see that.
I would.
What could have been?
What could have been? Casting choices. In an alternate reality, there's a movie of Batman Forever with Robin Williams as the Riddler.
Yes.
If I could just
make it happen, alternate universe, please.
Let me grab.
We must parallel dimensions to see that movie.
Seriously, just think about the parallel dimensions. You know, every casting choice that didn't happen in our universe must have happened in a different universe.
Yes, go to another universe where they finally made the Confederacy of Dunces with John Candy.
But
who's still alive.
Just, yeah. So, yeah, if you want to see a early Christopher Nolan film, like, especially after Memento, Insomnia is an interesting film to watch. I mean, Al Pacino, you gotta love Al Pacino, and then you might be interested to see what Robin Williams' character is. I mean, I thought it was quite interesting. I mean, he wasn't comedic. He was holding it back so bad. You could tell because he was just, like, whispering half the time. He was, like, trying to be serious and very menace in the process.
Menace, you say?
Oh, yeah, you could tell. You could tell by the tone of his voice. He was very menacing. Like, you don't want to mess with him because he might fight you and try to shoot you down. I mean, man, he at the end, 15 minutes is worth it because he pulls out the punches. Literally, he fights Al Pacino and then pulls out a gun and shoots at Al Pacino. So, hello, you don't see it in any other film like that.
Dude.
Anyways, let's go with some lighthearted goodness with James Sullivan with another 90s film.
Yes. Childhood favorite. I'm, of course, talking about Mrs. Doubtfire. One of several Williams films that in the 90s, if I had the luck to go see it, I'd see it again. And so, yeah, I saw this movie twice in the theater. And one time, ironically, was with a best friend of mine whose parents just a couple years before divorced. And how ironic, because that's the big theme of the film, is the subject of divorce and how it affects the family. And it actually is a very well balanced film when dealing with that subject. It knows when it's got to be funny, and it knows when it's got to take itself seriously. And Williams, just a couple years prior to making the film, had actually gone through his first divorce, so a lot of the anxiety that you see coming through in his performance is actually pretty genuine. There's moments in the film where everyone remembers it for being the character of Mrs. Doubtfire. He plays her off as being this elderly Mary Poppins type, which is which is trying to be perfect in every way. And he does a great job of it, but then there's times where he's sitting down in dressed up in character at a distance and actually saying stuff under his breath about how the situation is going playing out with his ex-wife, and you realize there's some animosity there. The animosity that he brings through in this performance, it's pretty real. And being a guy who actually knows a lot of people who have gone through divorce situations, I have felt that animosity by extension. what this film does is it weighs the situation out very well, I think. And I sort of think it's a must-see for anyone who knows somebody or anyone who had these sorts of situations happen to themselves. Mm. It's kind of like a nursing moment. Mm-hmm. So that's my two cents on it. For the most part. Does anyone else have anything to add to that, or
yet another film I have not yet seen?
You have not seen Mrs. Doubtfire? Whoa. Time out. I was just about to say, I thought everyone had seen Mrs. Doubtfire. That's a movie that I thought everyone grew up on. Seriously?
Seriously.
Honestly, I'm the same with Mike, actually. I haven't seen it yet.
Oh, are you serious?
Oh, we have an appointment.
Double whammy.
What can I say? I mean...
How do you not see it? It was not present.
I don't know. It wasn't
present in my childhood. It never stuck out. I mean, I had Jumanji. I had freaking Jack. I didn't have Mrs. Doubtfire.
Yeah, we had a lot. Things can go wrong. Oh, look, Willy Wonka.
I know. Yeah. Sorry. I mean, that's the things I was...
freaking Jack?
Out. I know, right, Jack? It's just, I mean,
okay, but I'm not gonna go on the record and say Jack's really a hateful movie, but really compared to Mrs. Doubtfire,
it's no.
Been deprived, just, son.
You've been deprived, boy.
How do you?
I don't know. I just never got around. I never grew up with it, so. I guess I should have just like, oh, you know what? I should watch Mrs. Doubtfire one day. Never thought about it.
And I should like just... quintessential dude dressing up as a woman movie. That ranks up there in the list.
It just reminds me of Mr. Mom or fucking something else. I don't know.
Isn't that like some kind of thing in The Simpsons?
Okay, I'm about to blow you guys' minds with this connection here. Okay, follow this train of thought for a moment. Okay, we'll start with Dustin Hoffman. Dustin Hoffman in the early '80s had Tootsie.
Love that movie.
A movie in which he played a guy dressing in drag, becomes a TV star. Sorry.
Fridge was that?
Phone call. Dustin Hoffman later plays in Hook alongside Robin Williams.
Right.
Robin Williams goes on to play Mrs. Doubtfire, a story of a man who dresses in drag to be with his kids and later becomes a TV star.
God.
It was a passing of the torch.
Oh my God,
but it
really?
gets It gets even better. It gets even better. Robin Williams goes on to make The Birdcage with Nathan Lane, in which Nathan Lane dresses in drag.
Oh my god.
Like 6 degrees of separation of
cross chains. Do you know who did I pass the torch on the dragness?
Wait! Wait a minute, I know exactly.
You're gonna keep going with this. 6 degrees of drag.
Hold on. Nathan Lane appears. Wait a sec. Where is it?
He was in Gold Member.
That doesn't count. That's not the one I'm thinking of. In 2005, Nathan Lane appears in The Producers, in which Gary Beach, as Roger Debris, comes out in a dress that looks like the Chrysler Building.
That is
so
very much
so
true.
Nathan Lane passed on the torch to Gary Beach.
So who did he pass it on to?
Oh my god.
I need to figure out. I want to know if Gary Beach appeared in that Broadway show with Neil Patrick Harris, where Neil Patrick Harris was cross-dressing. I know.
But wait. It gets even spicier. There was a fork in the road. Mrs. Doubtfire also had Harvey Fierstein playing.
Gay guy.
A gay guy. Robin Williams' character's gay brother. Harvey Fierstein goes on to do Hairspray on Broadway.
Oh my god.
Playing the mom.
I could see that.
What the?
So now we have to continue this torch passing on to John Travolta. And see who he passes the torch to.
Oh,
this is like the ice bucket challenge of Hollywood.
Is anybody at home following this? This is the 6 degrees of drag.
Well, Forrest Whitaker was in, like, Battlefield Earth, and they had those big Whoopi Goldberg-like dreads. Would that count? Cross-dressing?
No, that would be jumping back in time.
And I don't think that was Forrest Whitaker. That was some other black guy.
It was John Travolta.
No, he was with some other guy that was in that.
Other black guy.
But it was... I said Forrest Whitaker, but that's wrong. No. Some other guy.
Okay. Let's move on. Yes. I'm going to go see Mrs. Doubtfire. Are you going to be satisfied, people?
No, because you waited too long.
You, we got a date.
That's a crime. That's like his, like...
And now a date? That means the torch has been passed to James.
Who's wearing the dress out of the two of you? Who's pitching? Who's catching?
It's too late. It's too late. Actually, whoa. I already crashed a baby shower once wearing drag. True story. I have the picture.
And it's too late for me. I already dressed in drag for some theater productions a while back. So
it's the hair, right?
Mike, your turn.
Damn it. Oh my god.
Next podcast. We want to see you right front and center. Lipstick and all.
Lipstick on that pig.
No comment. Speechless.
And instead of Good Morning Vietnam, we're gonna have Mike do like Mrs. Doubtfire.
Headphones are off.
Welcome to Cinema Royale, dearies.
Not listening.
All right, dearies, and with today's podcast we got James Sullivan, also known as Jaimetud.
Oh, and a big knock on the door. Who could that be? Oh, it's Matt Brunet, our neighbor from the north.
Oh my gosh.
What is going on?
I'll tell you what's going on. Ideas for fan art. Go do it.
Oh no.
Oh, no. You be the artist.
Oh my god. I'm gonna draw this. Post it online. Okay. Matt.
Okay.
Yes.
You have a film that also came out in 2006, the same year as Happy Feet.
Yes. Yes, it is, actually. And this is another comedy. He is not the main star, but it's actually one of the better films in his later years. It's Night at the Museum, the one where Ben Stiller goes into a museum and suddenly everything comes to life. And I really got to say, it really is, you know, it's a fun, wholesome family flick, because, like, not only do you have the fun moments when we see Ben Stiller interacting with all the different art exhibits coming to life, but also it has a really good message to learn your history and stuff. It's really important to know your history, where things are from. You know, it really does pass down a good message. And as for Robin Williams, he actually plays Teddy Roosevelt, and oh my God, he really does look like the old president, does he? You know, and he actually plays it pretty well. Like, you know, this is, funny enough, it's actually one of his more serious roles, but he actually plays it off well. You know, he's more the, more of an authoritarian, but also, interestingly enough, he actually has the hots for, I'm trying to remember. Yeah, for Sacagawea. He has the hots for Sacagawea.
Remember that point in the history? I don't know. Hysteria.
He plays he plays as this great, like, mostly the leader, the one that introduces Ben Stiller around the museum. And, a lot of the other characters are, you know, they're fun to check out as well. Like, Owen Wilson and, trying to remember who else. Like, and another person, another guy, I forgot his name. But, like, this, like, literally cowboys and Romans duking it out. Like, they're both miniature Romans. And, like, they bring out a lot of interesting characters and some historical figures, like, coming to life, including, like, Attila the Hun and those people. And it really is, and Christopher Columbus, too. And then we also got, like, the Easter Island head with his gum-gum. And, you know, like, it really is a lighthearted, family fun comedy. You know, good message, great, nice comedy. It's all around fun, I will say.
What do you think about Night at the Museum 2?
I actually didn't like it as much, honestly. And mostly, it's actually from Amy Adams as Amelia Earhart. I don't know what it is, but she's really annoying in this. I just find her so annoying. Like, she really hams it up. She really hams up her performance to the point where, like it's really annoying. Like, she's just there. You know, I'm trying to be the sporty woman of the 20s. But I'm doing this all the time, non-stop. Even, like, when I'm trying to be serious, I'm always like this. So, as you can tell, it can get annoying real quick.
Come up and see me sometime.
Yes, darling, exactly. I don't know why Ben Stiller even stayed there for that long with me talking.
So she's doing the same accent as she did in American Hustle, then, essentially.
Kind of.
Oh, yeah.
Twice as much.
It is twice as much in Night at the Museum, yeah.
Twice as much, I would say.
At any point, I'm actually going to break character and just start singing, "How does she know you love her?
How does she know that you love her?
And then everyone will suddenly have fun with her character.
Yeah.
But here's a good thing, sort of. There's a third movie going to come out soon, and Robin Williams has his role again. He reprises it again, but it's a post-death role.
A post-mortem role.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I'm checking it right now. Apparently, Ben Stiller is now going to London.
Yep.
And it's going to have characters, like, apparently, they have Lancelot.
Yep, they have... I thought it was King Arthur, but yeah, it's with that. They have Rebel Wilson in it as a guard, and she's like, "You gotta watch the trailer sometime. It's really hilarious."
I don't know. I didn't see Night at the Museum 2. With Night at the Museum, I thought it was enjoyable, but it was not something that I was gonna necessarily come back to. And now with hearing you guys talking about how the second one went down, it doesn't.
Yeah,
I avoided that one. With the third one, it's.
Holy crap! We got another post actor in this. Apparently, Mickey Rooney is actually reprising his role.
Oh yeah.
Oh yes, that's right.
Mickey Rooney passed away.
Yeah. In April.
Oh, I didn't even get. There's so many deaths this year, man. I'm sorry.
2014 is depressing, man.
Awful.
Yeah, 2014 sucks with being a celebrity, you know.
Yeah.
It's like. Have you ever heard the expression? Celebrity death comes in threes.
Oh yeah.
Well, 2014 death is saying just screw you, you know.
Yeah.
I'll kill whoever I want.
That's
no.
pretty much half. The Oscars right now. Half the Oscars right there. Now it's just going to be the memorial.
Oh, hell yeah. Half an hour of it, right? I wouldn't mind that. I'd rather that than a stupid, like, bloated musical performance. Just half an hour of remember this person, that person.
And I will always love you.
Played on repeat for three times. Yes. Or every I Will Remember You song ever made just played back and back.
Yeah,
and back.
Pretty much.
Sarah McLachlan. Mm-hmm. And Amy Grant.
Each cover.
Yes.
God.
Yes. Even Dolly Parton, who wrote the song, by the way.
She wrote it, but that's my.
I thought he was saying Dolly Parton was dead. I was like, oh
no,
my God.
She wrote the
song.
No. She's. All right, let's get.
She's got her life preservers. Don't worry about it.
Whoa, man, a boo joke. Way to go.
Highbrow.
If there's one post-mortem Robin Williams performance I am looking forward to, though, it's absolutely anything. Story of a teacher experiences a series of mishaps after discovering he has magical powers. And the teacher in this case is played by Neil Clark, played by Simon Pegg. Robin Williams plays the voice of Dennis the dog, it says. So Robin Williams is a talking dog, and the rest of the cast is a Monty Python reunion.
Yeah, they got the cast of Monty Python. Oh my God, that actually looks
Terry amazing. Gilliam, Eddie Izzard, John Cleese, Eric Idle, Michael Palin.
Well, they say that Terry Jones is the director, so.
Yeah, Terry Jones. Wait,
so why'd they even bother doing a live one then if they're just going to bring them all together and this?
I don't know. Terry Jones is like, "Hey, boys, do you mind if you can help me with this?" Yeah, sure there, Terry. I'll do it for you. What do you want me to do? Well, you're all going to be extraterrestrials. Oh, that's going to be fun.
Mm-hmm. Well, we certainly got the voices for it, yes.
God. Let's just wrap this up. Let's just end it with Sylvie's movie choice.
Yes. Okay.
I want to pick one that hasn't been mentioned tonight yet. Has robots ever been called in, like, today or any previous episode?
Nope. Go ahead.
Let's just say robots. So it's basically him doing his shtick that he did in Aladdin and Ferngully.
Mm-hmm. Pretty much.
He played Fender. Not as good, though. Not as good. It was a more subdued performance. At least I remember. I don't... overall, I don't find Robots a very good film. It's visually stunning. Like, it's a beautiful to look at. But the story wasn't very good. It's just the villain wasn't very good. It's just the contrived romance. It's just...
It's all over the place.
Even Robin Williams couldn't save that one.
What's really interesting with Robots is that this is a William Joyce film. William Joyce, if you may recall, he has actually been working on a lot of animated films with a lot of different studios. He worked on... he worked on Meet the Robinsons. He worked on Rise of the Guardians. He even worked on Epic. And with Robots, it pretty much has the same problem, the same strengths and weaknesses as those previous films. They're great. In terms of visuals and animation, it's fantastic. It really immerses you, and like you're in this, like it's this really imaginative big world of robots, and just like pretty much the world of robots really is interesting in itself. However, the biggest problem is that he's not a very good writer, so the writing is pretty much lacking, and like even the characters are not really as interesting. Like, they look interesting, but they're not as interesting. Some of these you remember what they look like, but you don't really remember much of who they are because they're pretty much some of the generic characters. You remember more like the actors who play them. There's one that's played by Drew Carey. There's one that's played by Amanda Bynes before she went insane. There's Robin Williams. There's the main character who is Ewan McGregor and all those things. So, like, pretty much, it's not even different from some of the Blue Sky films, because even Blue Sky has a reputation, like, to have some good animation, but their writing is usually pretty crappy. And, like, that's the thing. It's the typical William Joyce film, and it's also the typical Blue Sky film. Like, it's Robots, it's okay, but meh.
Yeah. I will say it handled genocide in an interesting way for kids to digest. That's the best I can say for it.
Genocide? Wait.
Think about it, because essentially it's the old robots getting brushed away. That's what it is. But it's a pretty heady topic, but they kind of make it palatable for 5 and 6 year olds.
Mm-hmm.
You know, who's got that going for it, I guess. Sorry, not so.
Let's celebrate our genocide. No.
Oh, yeah.
With robots, the most effort that goes into it is an impressive across-the-town trolley scene, which looks really, really cool, but I'd never want to ride it.
He's throwing up everywhere.
Uh-huh. It's like all my Capsella toys come to life at once.
Wow. With that, we finally conclude this episode of our memorial of Robin Williams. He is
If I may... Oh, go on, actually.
No, you go on then if you want to interject.
Oh, no. Snap. There was just one extra thing that I want to say about Robin Williams, but if you were, you can go on.
As I was saying, Robin Williams is a great actor. He's a very funny comedian. You should check out his comedic television specials and his albums. Mm-hmm. So, Robin Williams, rest in peace.
Mm-hmm. And if there is one more thing I just want to say about Robin Williams, and it really is true, I remember just yesterday, actually, I went to see a panel, and it has Ron Clements and John Musker. And these are the directors of films like The Little Mermaid, Aladdin, The Princess and the Frog, and all those films. And there was a moment they did talk about Robin Williams. What they said when working with Robin Williams is pretty much true, is that the more energy he gives, the more energy he gets. So, like, Robin Williams would start low power. And when he would read the scripts for Aladdin, like, he would just read it a few times and, like, around 7 or 8 times. And then suddenly he'll be like, okay, can I do this thing? And then, like, there'll be moments he'll do more recordings where it's like, okay, can I do this thing? Okay, and I want to do this thing. Hold on. Okay, I want to do it again. I have this idea. And what it happens is that the people at Disney end up getting more than what they bargained for with Robin Williams because they got so much great material to work with. And I think that's one of the biggest things that I really got off of John Musker and Ron Clements is that the more energy that Robin Williams the more energy Robin Williams gives out, the more energy he gets. Because it's true. When you watch a performance by Robin Williams, you really do get this major pumped up energy that he pretty much delivers. It's so fast paced, it's so think on his feet, like, and so unpredictable of what else will he think of next. Like, it really gets you on the edge, like, on the edge of your seat, like, wondering, like, what else Robin Williams is going to think of next. So he's definitely a great energy giver. Mm-hmm. And that's what I want to say about Robin Williams.
Very nice.
Amen to that.
You're here.
Amen. Hallelujah. Well, before we end it off, let's talk about what the next episode is going to be. I don't know. I have a schedule, but I'm willing to try something new with you guys. I'm willing to have suggestions. I know it's on the spot.
Suggestions?
Eddie Murphy.
Us?
Well, wait. Let me rewind it back. Next month is October. So I want a Halloween-themed movie topic.
I was about to suggest, we could follow up one memorial episode with another for Joan Rivers, but
What films did Muppets. She do?
She was in the Muppets.
Yeah, other than Muppets Take Manhattan.
She was in Spaceballs. That's all I got.
Yeah, we'd spend an hour and a half talking about Spaceballs.
Yeah, that's the problem.
Or Mel Brooks films or something. Okay.
Or how about DreamWorks films?
I could do that. No.
Okay, but let's do Halloween.
We'll do stuff on Halloween.
Actually, screw it. I'll just go with my original plan.
Wow. We're not good for you.
You guys are not supportive.
How the fridge are we not supportive?
Ouch.
You're not giving me options.
I said Eddie Murphy.
Oh, yeah, we're talking. Oh, actually, okay. You.
You were saying?
I'm gonna wrap this up.
Oh,
let's go. I'm sorry. I'm so hop up on stuff.
Next episode, Mike's apologies.
Right. Mike prostrates himself for hours.
I just can't stop laughing. Oh my god. I don't know what to do. I'm breaking down.
Ghosts or boogeymen or...
We're talking Dracula movies.
Oh.
Vampire films.
Oh. I got one.
I know.
Vampire movies.
I got a great one, actually. I already know which one I'm going to do.
We're going to talk about vampires. You know what that means.
I'm going to let it shine. Let it shine. Let it shine. Let it shine.
So stay tuned, children of the night, until we talk about vampire films in October Spooktacular.
Where we are going to suck your blood.
Oh, I can tell it's going
to
be a fun.
I think I have an hour.
I would like to thank Krusty for that joke.
They haven't killed him off yet?
What? Is he going to be the one who's going to die?
Oh, they're hinting at it. Someone's going to die.
Oh, yeah. Someone's going to die, but...
Actually, this episode coincides with the release of Dracula Untold, the origin story of Dracula in a new retelling story.
Which is going to immediately suck because it's a neo-vampire story.
Either that or it's going to be like Maleficent where somehow they're going to turn Dracula into a fairy godmother.
I'd watch that.
Based on the trailers, it looks pretty interesting.
Or Dracula's a cross-dresser. It's the next Birdcage, I think.
And Frankenstein passed the torch to Dracula. Which Dracula will pass the torch to Andy Samberg? And which Andy Samberg is going to pass the torch to... Damn it. No.
He screwed it up. So, thanks for listening.
I think I've already got a picture of Dracula in drag.
Let's see it.
Francis Ford Coppola.
We got...
That works.
Oh, yeah. We got Dracula.
That's a sexy bitch.
This has been Cinema Royale, and I just want to shout this out for everybody. Follow us on Twitter, alright? Twitter has not been used for us, alright? Come on. People, follow us. You got James Sullivan is at Jaimetud, you got AniMat505, you got at Shame on Pretzel, and I'm at Mike Mixtape. Follow us on Twitter.
Yeah.
And if you want to see more episodes like this, especially like this, with all the laughter, subscribe to this channel, because you're going to see a lot more of this in the future. And if you like it, like this video as well. Other than that, let's... Heil Smoochie.
Heil Smoochie.
To commemorate Hitler, he would make a great rhino.
Good night and goodbye.
See you later, dudes.
Sayonara.
Ciao for now.